Welcome to my presentation titled The World's Guide to WCAG and Compliance. And the reason I say world is because accessibility is something that affects everyone. At the bottom of my slides is accessible.org. And continuing to the next slide, we have the objectives, which are to help everyone understand what WCAG is, what WCAG does, and how it relates to the law. And on this slide, I have a photo of an attorney. And on the next slide, we have the WCAG course and also an overview of the WCAG 2.1 AA requirements. If you are interested in learning the actual success criteria, so the actual accessibility behind the web content accessibility guidelines, I will include a link in the description. And I will also include a link to my full WCAG course available at WCAGcourse.com. And on this slide, we have an image of a laptop where we have a video call with a number of people on the call. All right, continuing on, let's get into the web content accessibility guidelines. These are technical standards for web accessibility. They are created by the World Wide Web Consortium. So you may have heard of the acronym W3C. It's created by the W3C under their Web Accessibility Initiative, WAI. The W3C creates standards that enable the interoperability of the web. So think of HTML, CSS, and they've developed many other standards. So the W3C has played an absolutely crucial part in the development of the web. And the WAI develops guidelines and resources to promote accessibility. All right, so what has been the impact of the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines? Well, these are globally recognized standards for accessibility. They have paved the way for millions of individuals with disabilities to be able to participate in the digital world. And the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines are the result of years of dedicated work from hundreds of experts and professionals around the world. All right, so let's actually get into the guidelines. There are multiple versions. 1.0 was published in 1999. 2.0 came out in 2008. In 2018, we had 2.1 released. And then just recently in 2023, we had the publishing of WCAG 2.2. It's important to know, and it's a very nice feature, that these different versions are backwards compatible, which means each successive version builds upon the previous version. And there is an asterisk here on this bullet point, and I will get to that asterisk in one moment. There are also three conformance levels. So there is single A, double A, and triple A. And we will get to more on conformance levels in a moment. And these different conformance levels are comprised of different success criteria. So these success criteria are the requirements that I was talking about earlier. What is necessary for conformance with these technical standards? Importantly, the success criteria take into account different disabilities, including visual, auditory, motor, and cognitive disabilities. This is an add-in to the presentation because I wanted to better explain what success criteria are. I've talked about how success criteria are requirements for conformance. Think of these requirements as different things to do for accessibility. So there are all these different considerations, and these success criteria are the different considerations. So when we look to the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, for each successive version and conformance level, there are additional success criteria or things to do for accessibility that are added. And now I'm going to move over to a new slide, and this is a screenshot of one of these success criteria, 1.4.1, use of color. And the requirement here is that color is not used as the only visual means of conveying information, indicating a response, indicating an action, prompting a response, or distinguishing a visual element. So this is actually one of the success criteria. And then I will go over one more example. So we have another screenshot. This is of 1.3.1, info and relationships. The requirement here is that information, structure, and relationships conveyed through presentation can be programmatically determined or are available in text. Now, this technical language gets to a point I will make later in the presentation, but the point here is now you know of two of the success criteria, so you have a better idea of what I'm referring to when I'm talking about success criteria. And that's it for this add-on, and we'll continue back with the presentation. All right, so one thing on the structure of the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, they are organized into four principles, and those principles are represented by the acronym of POUR, P-O-U-R, which stands for Perceivable, Operable, Understandable, and Robust. And underneath those principles are guidelines, and then the guidelines are comprised of success criteria. And that is where we direct our focus to the success criteria. And on the slide, we have a website that is displayed on different devices. All right, so the success criteria. With WCAG 2.0, we have 38 success criteria in conformance level AA. And then we have a successive version in WCAG 2.1. So with conformance level AA, all that happened with 2.1 is we just added 12 additional success criteria to 2.0. So think of 2.1 as 2.0 plus 12 more requirements. And then recently with 2.2, we had 6 additional success criteria published under conformance level AA. But importantly, on the slide here, I have that 2.2 AA only has 55 success criteria. And that is because the backwards compatible rule was broken for the first time. And we had a previous success criterion 4.1.1, which was parsing removed. But this was a more general requirement, basically that web pages are coded correctly, which is really implicit when you go through the different success criteria anyway. But this was the one instance where the backwards compatible rule was broken. All right, so on conformance levels, conformance level AA is essential. Think of it as success criteria that are essential for accessibility. With conformance level AA, we have success criteria that build on top of the essentials to ensure access to a broader audience of users with disabilities. And then when we look to AAA conformance, think of this as the highest threshold for accessibility within the web content accessibility guidelines. And so a good way to think about these different success criteria is single A is foundational to accessibility, double A creates a more comprehensive accessibility, and then AAA is really exceptional accessibility. All right, with the success criteria, it is very important to note that they vary in complexity. They also vary in the amount of work involved in conformance, the layers. So some success criteria are very simple and straightforward and just have one component to conformance, and then others have multiple layers that are necessary for conformance. Some success criteria have one or more exceptions. Other success criteria are objective, and some are more subjective in whether conformance has been met. And then the impact can also vary depending on the success criteria. And then on that slide, I also had some neon code, some really, really complicated code as an image on the slide. All right, continuing on. The web content accessibility guidelines are for web assets. So what would web assets be? Well, just generally think of web assets as being anything that you can access by a web browser. So websites, web pages, web applications. Think of software applications like email clients, so Gmail, or social platforms. Think of multimedia, so video, audio files like podcasts, images. And then also think about integrations like calendars, chatbots, maps, and the list goes on. And then there are also non-web assets. So sometimes we see the web content accessibility guidelines that are applied to non-web assets. And the important part here is that they apply unevenly. So it's not a perfect fit because, again, the web content accessibility guidelines are intended for web assets. But the principles and guidelines can be applied to non-web assets. So things such as documents, PDFs, Word documents, PowerPoints, spreadsheets, software, mobile apps, hardware. So these principles and guidelines for accessibility can be carried over into non-web assets. And then on this slide, I have an image of a hand holding up a mobile device, just here, just indicating that we have a non-web asset because we are opening up an app. All right. So speaking of non-web assets, as I alluded to, because WCAG does not apply perfectly for non-web assets, adaptation and interpretation may be needed as guidelines will not always translate to non-web assets. Also note that reaching the same level of accessibility as web content, it may not be feasible or practical due to technological limitations, design constraints, and other reasons. All right, so with the web content accessibility guidelines, we have a tremendous source. As I talked about earlier, so much work has gone into the web content accessibility guidelines. So leverage this open resource. Train your digital team on the web content accessibility guidelines. Integrate WCAG into your workflow and start creating accessible content and building accessible digital assets. And then update and edit those assets with accessibility in mind. When you do this, you transition from a disjointed X then Y process. So build our web asset and then work on accessibility. And then we're just building our web asset with accessibility in mind. So we really make it seamless so that we are creating accessible assets as a result of what we do rather than working on accessibility after the fact. All right. So note that we can optimize. We can go beyond the web content accessibility guidelines when working on accessibility. Although these guidelines are excellent standards for accessibility, there is more we can do. So for example, WCAG allows pop-ups. WCAG allows sliders. The web content accessibility guidelines also allow for audio to autoplay. And then ideally, we don't have any of these things in place. Also, we can strive for conformance beyond WCAG 2.1 AA, which is a best practice, but we can work towards WCAG 2.2 conformance and then even start looking at some of the AAA success criteria and work for conformance there. So just note that accessibility doesn't stop at the web content accessibility guidelines, but these are excellent technical standards to start working from. All right, now let's get into the law. And with the law, the first slide I have is I want to note that there is a difference between compliance and conformance. We often hear WCAG compliance as a phrase, but that's actually a colloquial term because it's technically incorrect. We seek to be in compliance with the law. We seek to be in conformance with technical standards such as WCAG. So although WCAG may be incorporated into the law, it is still not the law itself. It is the web content accessibility guidelines are in fact technical standards. So WCAG was not written to be a set of legal requirements, but rather technical standards for web developers, web designers, and content creators to follow for accessibility. So on this slide, I have the three tenets of good law, and this is a somewhat abrupt slide, but I will make sense of it in a moment. So when we look to law, what do we expect from the law? Well, we expect the law to be clear. We want it to be written in plain language and easy to understand. We want the law to provide certainty. So we want to know exactly what it takes to be compliant with the law. And we also want the law to be fair. So we want the law to promote equality, to prevent discrimination, and really to treat everyone equally. So uphold fairness. But when we look at the web content accessibility guidelines and we compare it to those three tenets of good law, the first thing we note is that WCAG is unclear. It's written in a highly technical language. Also, what does it take? Certain success criteria are subjective, so they're not objective. It's not easy to know yes or no, true or false, this success criterion has been met. Some success criteria are binary. Some are layered and or require technical evaluation to determine whether conformance has been met for a given success criterion. Also, there are significant requirements involved in conforming to the web content accessibility guidelines. So there is a technical complexity element that cannot be, we can't get around that. And then there's also just the cost of services were you to hire someone to make your website WCAG conformant. So there are significant resources involved when it comes to working towards full conformance with the web content accessibility guidelines. And then on this slide, we have the practical application. So if we are to require the conformance with the web content accessibility guidelines under the law, what that technically means is that if we have just one instance of nonconformance on one page of a website, the website owner is in violation of the law. So let's just say we have a 100-page website, and we know that under WCAG 2.1 AA, there are 50 success criteria. If one page of the website does not meet one success criterion, then if you incorporate the web content accessibility guidelines wholesale, that means that your website is discriminatory and in violation of the law. All right, so but best practice for compliance, and this is for compliance with any law, really. Material compliance with any law for digital accessibility is always, best practice is always full conformance with WCAG 2.1 AA or 2.2. But 2.1 is a great starting point. And then from there, remember, there are just six additional success criteria in 2.2. So we can just add to that. But if we start with 2.1 AA, that has been a longstanding best practice for material compliance with the law. And then, of course, prioritization of the pages and issues is key, especially in the ultra litigious legal landscape of the United States. But this is going to be the case anywhere because there are certain accessibility issues that you want to prioritize. And then also, of course, you want to make sure that the pages that are most trafficked on your website are the ones that you take care of first. All right. So on the slide here, I have not discrimination. So nonconformance or having some accessibility issues does not mean that access has been denied or discrimination has taken place. We must consider the totality of the circumstances of the claim. So what is that actually is going on in this specific circumstance or instance situation? All right. So, and then on the slide, we are very close to the end. I have an exercise. For those people who are let's say the lawmakers, let's just say the lawmakers, the legislators, really anybody that wants to require strict conformance with the web content accessibility guidelines, one exercise is to try to make an e-commerce website fully WCAG 2.1 AA conformant. And then the questions I have are, how much did it cost? How much time did it take? And were you able to make every single page conformant? And did you make sure that every single page conformant? And the purpose of this exercise is to get you to start thinking about what actually is involved when we require the web content accessibility guidelines under the law. If we require full conformance, what are we actually asking of website owners? And the end point here is to understand that this is quite an endeavor and it's quite a project. Although saying that you are required to fully conform with WCAG is very simple, the actual exercise of doing so is actually quite complex and lengthy for most websites. So it's important to keep in mind that there are all of these success criteria, and they're uneven and they're layered and they're non-binary, and some are have subjectivity as a part of them. So just understanding that will make you better understand, okay, the web content accessibility guidelines are excellent standards for web accessibility, but they are technical standards and they are not meant to be applied strictly when it comes to compliance with the law. All right, to summarize this presentation, WCAG is a very helpful set of technical standards, and it is an excellent reference for digital accessibility. But incorporation of the web content accessibility guidelines into the law can be problematic. WCAG is extremely technical, and nonconformance should not necessarily amount to a violation of the law. Again, we have to look at the circumstances. So that is the conclusion of this presentation. My name is Kris Rivenberg. You can email me at kris@accessible.org. I'm the author of the ADA book. I'm the founder of accessible.org, and I offer services, accessibility services, out of accessible.org. These services include an audit, remediation, and user testing. Also, I offer training out of adacompliance.net, and that training includes the WCAG course, and I will include a link to the WCAG course in the description for this video.